introduction of the F-117 Nighthawk was a watershed moment in military aviation. After years of competing to field faster moving, higher flying aircraft that could outrun or outclimb enemy air defenses, the Nighthawk adopted a new approach to fighting in contested airspace: stealth. Using the most powerful computers of the era, Lockheed Skunk Works developed an aircraft that could elude enemy defenses, rather than defeating them through brute strength alone. As we've discussed on this channel before, stealth is not a single technology, but rather a whole slew of overlapping technologies, production methodologies, and battlefield strategies. No stealth aircraft, not even today's F-35 Joint Strike Fighter, is truly invisible to radar, or infrared detection for that matter. But a well-designed stealth aircraft will delay detection for as long as possible, while also making it really difficult to secure a weapons-grade lock. In other words, even when enemy forces are aware that there's a stealth jet in their airspace, they'll have a heck of a time trying to shoot it down. Although the first F-117 flew in 1981, the U.S. Air Force refused to acknowledge the existence of the world's first operational stealth plane until 1988, which was 5 years after the F-117 actually entered operational service. The world, however, was already vaguely aware that Uncle Sam was keeping some exotic-looking secrets in the hangars of Area 51. Before the F-117 was even unveiled to the public, software developer MicroProse had already released a video game based on the Nighthawk called F-19 Stealth Fighter. Why F-19, you ask? Well, the Air Force hadn't revealed the Nighthawk's real name yet, so most of us, including MicroProse, just assumed the next fighter jet to join the branch would be dubbed the F-19. Of course, today, we know the F prefix in F-117 was a misnomer by design. Despite the Nighthawk's incredible ability to sneak past enemy defenses, technological limitations at the time of its development meant that the new stealth fighter was no fighter at all. Would probably be more apt to call the F-117 an attack aircraft. It had no onboard radar, limited speed and acrobatic capabilities, and a payload capacity of just two small diameter bombs. But despite all of those clear limitations, Lockheed actually pitched the idea of a practically all-new iteration of the F-117 that would have been meant for duty on the U.S. Navy's supercarriers. This program, dubbed the F-117N Seahawk, would have resulted in the most capable and advanced stealth aircraft of its day, and it would have put the Air Force's F-117 to shame. Way back in 1993, while Jurassic Park and Mario Brothers were in theaters, Lockheed Martin approached the U.S. Navy with a proposal for a carrier-based iteration of their famed stealth fighter. This all-new F-117N would be a low-observable, all-weather strike aircraft, and at the time, it really seemed like the logical progression for America's air power. The Navy was already operating some highly capable fighters in the F-A-18 Hornet and the F-14 Tomcat, but these fourth-generation fighters were anything but stealthy. And while the Hornet was intended to serve in both a fighter and an attack role, hence its F-A prefix, the F-14 was largely intended to serve as an intercept fighter, built specifically to engage Soviet bombers. An F-117 would have offered the Navy a significant capability jump, provided they could make it work on their aircraft carriers. The initial proposal Lockheed approached the Navy with didn't look that different from the Air Force's Nighthawk. All they really added was an automated carrier landing system and a corrosion-resistant coating to combat the seawater that this new aircraft could be exposed to. The Navy, however, was way more interested in fielding a high-speed multi-role fighter. The Nighthawk just wasn't that, so the Navy rejected the proposal outright. Later, Lockheed was again rejected by the Royal Air Force, so they went back to the drawing board to create a new F-117 specifically for sea duty, and this time, they included a slew of upgrades and improvements. Seemingly already aware that the operational F-117 wasn't the most capable combat aircraft around, Lockheed's new pitch offered a drastically improved iteration of the platform, complete with double the internal payload capabilities of the first. The wings would be given a 42-degree sweep, rather than the 50-degree sweep you could find on the existing Nighthawk, and they would extend out 50% further, all the way to 64 feet. At the tail of the aircraft, additional horizontal ailerons were added to make it more manageable at the low speeds that are really required for carrier landings. Like the first proposal, this new Seahawk would also include the automated carrier landing system, heavier duty landing gear, and a tailhook that's required for short landings at sea. During flight, the tailhook would be stowed internally to prevent it from compromising the aircraft's stealth design. The wings themselves would also be designed to fold up, just like any other carrier-based fighter, allowing for easier storage below deck. Aware that the Navy was not at all satisfied with the Nighthawk's top speed of right around 680 miles per hour, Lockheed looked to the more powerful F-114 engines that would eventually find a home in the Super Hornet. These afterburning turbofans built by GE produced 13,000 pound-feet of thrust each under normal operation, and as much as 22,000 pound-feet with the afterburner engaged. Using a pair of these engines in the Seahawk would have made it significantly faster than its Air Force sister, and potentially could have made it a supersonic jet. In order to address the limited payload capacity of the first F-117, the new F-117N would leverage its more powerful engines and larger weapons bay to carry more munitions than ever before, including air-to-air missiles on the inside of each weapons bay door. The carrier-based Seahawk's missiles would take their cues from a multi-mode air-to-air, air-to-ground radar, and an infrared search and track system comparable to what may be found in many fighter jets. In other words, Lockheed's proposed new, quote, stealth fighter would have actually been the world's first actual stealth fighter. Lockheed also told the Navy that they could increase the payload capacity even further by using a bulging bomb bay door, which, all told, would increase its payload capacity to 10,000 pounds, as opposed to the F-117A's 2,000-pound payload limit. External hardpoints, similar to those leveraged on the F-35 and F-22 today, would have allowed for an additional 8,000 pounds of external munitions. Of course, using those external hardpoints would compromise the aircraft's stealth profile, so you could really only utilize that capability in uncontested airspace. By 1995, Lockheed was confident in their new design, and they proposed the Seahawk to the U.S. Navy at a per-unit price of $70 million, assuming a total order of 255 airframes. And part of Lockheed's sales pitch really was that this new Seahawk would not be relegated strictly to its Air Force sibling's attack role. Thanks to its larger payload, higher top speed, and fighter-like avionics, the Navy's own F-117 would truly be a multi-role fighter. But it may have actually been that stealth fighter approach that made the Seahawk's failings start to become more and more evident. You see, the original F-117 Nighthawk was born out of the HAVBLUE technology demonstrator program, which itself grew out of a computer-generated form mathematically designed by DARPA, or the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. The idea was to reflect electromagnetic waves, like those leveraged by radar, to limit an aircraft's detection. But the limited computer technology of the time forced a strangely angular design, which those involved in the effort jokingly referred to as the hopeless diamond. And while the Nighthawk born of this effort did eventually prove airworthy, it still prioritized stealth over in-flight performance, and as a result, could be a real handful to fly. Even with more powerful engines and more weapons at its disposal, the F-117's design could still only do so much. It was becoming clear that an entirely new stealth fighter platform could leverage more advanced computing technology to create a fighter that was both stealthy and highly capable. And that's a concept that Lockheed themselves proved true just 2 years later when their F-22 Raptor first began test flights. Soon thereafter, the Navy would throw in on the Pentagon's new Joint Strike Fighter program, aiming to make one stealth jet that could meet the needs of the Navy, the Air Force, and the Marine Corps. That program, of course, would go on to develop the F-35. So, while the F-117N Seahawk never actually came to fruition, the premise itself offers a unique insight into the early days of stealth technology. The field of aviation was advancing so rapidly throughout the Cold War and immediately thereafter that by the time the Navy had a chance to seriously consider fielding stealth jets on their carriers, America's top-tier stealth platform was already just too dated to be practical. Of course, it would take nearly three more decades for the U.S. Navy to get a stealth fighter onto its carriers, and that really goes to show just how advanced the Seahawk premise was at the time. If the premise of the Seahawk just seems as cool to you as it does to me, make sure you check out our video on the Sea Raptor, which was the effort just a few years later to try to stick F-22 Raptors aboard the Navy's carriers. Obviously, that effort didn't pan out either, but I love the idea of some alternate dimension out there with America's supercarriers steaming through the Pacific, with F-117s and F-22s on board. And it's with that wistful idea that another edition of Sandbox News comes to a close. I'm Alex Hollings. Make sure you swing by sandboxnews.com today and every day for all the latest in news, entertainment, and motivation from all around the force. If you got anything out of this video, go ahead and click like and subscribe down below, and please leave a comment. I have a blast reading them all. And once you're subscribed, don't forget to tap on that bell icon so you never miss a drop from Sandbox News.